done by the Foundation for Restoration of St. Genevieve. We hope you had a good time and could attend the reception yesterday evening, and we want to thank Hank Johnson for very generously letting us see the Becca Rebo House on St. Mary's Road. That was a very enjoyable experience. I had never been in the house before, so I especially enjoyed being there. Without further ado, Sandra Kev is going to announce the speakers for today. Sandra is our Director of Tourism and Economic Development. I'm not good at memorizing things, so I'm just going to read this. She's a member of the Board of Directors for the Foundation of Restoration, currently serving as Vice President. She is a graduate of Valley High School and Williams Woods University. Her professional career has focused on marketing, communications, and business development. After living out of state for several years, Sandra returned to St. Genevieve in 1997 with her husband and two children. She was a founding member of the St. Genevieve County Community Foundation and has served as its president since 2003. She also serves as board member for the St. Genevieve Downtown Renewals Budget Executive Board. I wouldn't have said all that. I would just say that she's a lot better to look at than I am. So we'll just go on with the program. Okay, Sandra, there you go.
Thank you, Al.
You're welcome.
Our first speaker this morning will be Paul Robitaille. He is an independent researcher from Bozeman, Montana. He has a Bachelor of Science in Environmental Science from Towson State University of Maryland. He's a Navy veteran from the Vietnam period and worked in the defense industry for 35 years. In 2010, he retired as Director of Systems Engineering for Lockheed Martin Corporation. Paul is a member of the Missouri Historical Society, the French Canadian Heritage Society of Michigan, the Oklahoma Historical Society, and the Center for French Colonial Studies. He's also a life member of the Fort Niagara Association. He has previously published articles related to his presentation today in the Michigan Habitat Heritage Magazine and the Bulletin de l'Association de Famille Robitaille. Paul's presentation today will be Louis Robitaille Silversmith. Please help me welcome Paul Robitaille.
Thank you. St. Genevieve shortly thereafter. So let's start the presentation. All right, great. The name in French is pronounced Robitaille, and it gets murdered every day in any place south of Quebec province. I've been through that many, many times. Just to give you a little timeline here of Louis's life, he was born 1768 in a small town right outside of Quebec City known as Anse-en-Lorraine. It is the ancestral home of virtually all of the North American Robitailles. The family came to Canada in 1670. Two brothers, one brother, Philippe, the one that I'm related to, was the most prodigious the Robitailles that came here. He's probably the sire of about 80% of Robitailles in North America. Just an incredible, productive line of people. Louis was actually a twin. He was born the same day as his sister Francoise. And he started running his trade by virtue of a connection that was made by one of his sisters, who married a notable Canadian Ian Silversmith by the name of Amio. And Amio is well-known in Quebec province, a very sophisticated, very talented silversmith. He made a lot of religious objects for churches, some of the government buildings and things of that type, gold as well as silver. Now, the thing I should have explained at the very beginning, when we use this term orfèvre, it's a French term for goldsmith slash silversmith that covers both aspects of the trade. Anyway, in 1789, he marries Louise Monroe. That's an English name, actually Scottish name. Her family, her father came from Scotland, her mother was from Quebec. And they got married in 1789. And the list of people that attended that wedding included some of the Amio family, some of the brothers. There were a number of people in that family who were silversmiths. So he learned his trade roughly from 1783 to 1788 in Quebec City, working for initially the Amio family as an apprentice. Typically in those days, apprenticeships started about age 16, lasted until about 20, or a little less than 20, and then they would set up their own business. Louis signed his marriage contract and his actual marriage certificate as Louis Robitaille Orfèvre. So we presume that by that time he was actually a practicing soldier. They started building a family almost as quick as they got married. Two daughters were born in Quebec City. Both were baptized at Notre Dame in Quebec. I'll show you some pictures later of that. And then the first son, who was a bit of an enigma with research that we did, because we haven't really found the paperwork for his birth. We've pieced this together based on his age of death, but it's an approximate date somewhere between 1792 and 1793. We saw another son later and was surprised to see that his name, you'll see it as I go through the presentation, his name was not Louis, and it was very customary, as many of you probably know, that the son was always named after the father. So we were just, you know, we figured there must have been another boy somewhere along the line. Sure enough, towards the end of this pitch, you'll see where he comes to life. There's only one silver artifact that we've actually found for this period of Quebec. I suspect there's probably more, but I'll show you a picture of that in a moment. Picture of the ancestral church. That church, much like your church here in St. Genevieve, was born, built on foundation after foundation. It sits literally where the church was, where we would have been born and baptized in his hometown. Notre Dame de Quebec, similar story. The church is not exactly the same church that was there when he was married, but it's on the same foundation, right in the middle of downtown Quebec, in the old part of the city. And on the bottom, Basse-Ville, which is the lower town, looking at this picture, you can just see up here on the upper level of the town, the roof line of Chateau Frontenac, which is a nice hotel there in town, one of the nicest ones in town today. But this is right below that. There's a little cable or funicular that comes down between the upper town and the lower town. The lower part of town, Basse-Ville, as they call it, goes to the home of many artisans at that period of time. Virtually all the Amios had shops that were there. Then you had a shop down there and lived there for a period of time to live in Quebec City. This is the sole artifact that we found so far for him in Quebec. And I have shown the spoon. It was made for the Jean-Philippe family that were also from Quebec City. And the thing that makes me believe that this was probably an artifact that was found in Canada, you'll see two markings very similar to the marking that I showed in the cover of my presentation. L dot R. You just barely see the dot. There is actually a raised dot. It looks almost like a little pimple on the spoon. That's his trademark, his hallmark for everything that he made. You'll see it show up over and over again in the objects I showed you pictures of. The piece in the middle is a rampant lion. It's got one claw higher than the other, and it's a standard pseudo mark of silver for silver that was made in Canada at a particular time in Quebec province as well as Ontario. Now, Louis was up against some pretty tough competition in Quebec. He because there have been a number of French silversmiths that have been in place for quite some time, actually very talented ones. And all of the records that we found, there were quite a few, kind of show that he was having a hard time staying above water. And he had, you know, 3 mouths to feed in addition to his own. He's forced to leave a place that he was renting. He bought a house, and then the house got repossessed because he couldn't make his payments. And so I think, my characterization of him is he was probably in over his head in Quebec City as far as talent goes and competition, and jobs weren't quite that plentiful. 1759, if you know the history of Quebec province, the British took the town after contesting New France and winning the French and Indian War. So along with that came some English soldiers in addition to the French that were there, and they were a number. So make a long story short, he doesn't stay long. He moves on to Detroit. Detroit was a pretty small place. It had also become British from the time he moved there. England had possessed everything just about east of the Mississippi by that point, because the French and Indian War had run its course. And the American Revolution had came a little bit later, but in 1796, right about a little bit after he got there, in fact, after he left, the British left, so it would have been largely a British-dominated government in town. But he gets to Detroit and he finds out, guess what? There's about 4 or 5 other silversmiths in Detroit. So he didn't really produce anything that we've been able to find. He was in Detroit. Stayed there a short time. One daughter was born and baptized in St. Anne of Detroit, the church that was there. And very little mention in the literature, and practically nothing of archival significance. So he was mentioned in John Aston's papers as being present as one of the silversmiths that was there in town. Possibly he may have been involved in making some Indian trade silver at that point, because a lot of silversmiths did that on the side to make money if they couldn't get a commission from the large. 1796, Louis goes back to. So in Quebec, he doesn't stay long. He went back principally because the house that he had bought from one of his wife's guardians actually got repossessed in the bank. They had a bank sale and sold the property to somebody else. When he goes back to Quebec, the daughter that was born in Detroit, unfortunately, dies about the same time. I think they must have been pretty frustrated because they cut the cord with Quebec and didn't go back to that point. So he moves on to St. Genevieve. St. Genevieve is probably the most productive period for his trade in producing silver. I'll show you a number of pictures of things that were made while he was in the Illinois country. And we'll talk about some of the other significant advances for the next chart. This is an actual copy of the church records here in town of the baptism of his second son, Pierre Francois. And it was signed by Robert Maxwell, a guy who's an interesting fellow in his own right. I'm sure you all know about him. He's a real estate entrepreneur, he's a hunter, he's a traveler. He's a pretty interesting fellow as far as a Catholic cleric goes. He doesn't just do mass, he does a lot of things. You can see Louis' signature down here on the bottom. And the interesting thing is Francois Gallet was present at the baptism, which probably wasn't that unusual with a lot of things that they did here. But Louis Courtois was there as well. So interesting and very, very clear, very legible record. I'm really pleased to find that. And the chart, please. One of the things that another paper artifact from this period in St. Genevieve is a promissory note. This is all written in French to Monsieur de Loisel, who promised to make 12 silver spoons for it. Loisel was up in St. Louis, so this was a note that he made. He said, I promised to make 12 perfect silver spoons for you, and sort of a contract promissory note, probably to get some of the money you needed to get them materials to them to start the project. We never found out what happened to the spoon. There's no record of what was all did to the spoons. Maybe they're around still somewhere, but none of them have been found to date, to my knowledge. This was provided very generously by Eric Newman, who's saying this is the point collector and collector society. Rather elderly fellow, I hope he, I don't know if he's still with us or not. I sent him a copy of my paper, which I promised. I never heard anything back, so I wasn't sure if he was even around. I know he's getting pretty old. But it was really nice to get that. It's an interesting artifact in the story. Louis had a habit of, when he came to the Illinois company, of adding an extra stamp to all the silver that he produced, not just to his home. So here you see a picture of a fork, a three-plane fork, that we don't know who it was made for. There are no engravings on the top, and there are clues to the person who commissioned this book was. But this spelling, which is, I believe, the French spelling for Illinois, I think they only used one out of four. Louis didn't really spell very good, one of the two. But at any rate, all of his work that he did in the Mississippi River Valley is marked the same way. Sometimes with two of his hallmarks flanking the other way. This chart, he didn't do the soup for the river. That was done by a Frenchman from Bordeaux. Picture was provided by the Missouri Historical Museum, a history museum like St. Louis. The label is the product that we made. And it's a nice one. It's engraved, and it was made for the local family, so there's a big flowery medium on the level. And the reverse of that has the same LR with the Illinois stamp on it. This is probably his crowning jewel. Terms of the objects that he made. Pretty sophisticated for the time. We think this was made somewhere between late 1790s and maybe 1804. It now resides in the Yale University Art Gallery. I understand that Yale's got all the pieces in that museum as well. But this is really for its day, it was a pretty progressive design. It wasn't the, if you go back and see the difference, the French one is much more flowery and ornate, and it's a much more ornate piece. But and it looks almost like a soup. It's not big enough to do that. It's actually shaped, it's shaped sort of like a wonderful shape. And if you go to look at Louis, it's a much more modern line to it. It's all decorated along the bottom with a regal work type design, some lines and little kind of just unrelated curved set of lines on the bottom. Next chart. This is the last article I believe we've got pictures of, but Louis made another piece. This one was for Beauvais St. Jean, who's a drinking company. And it's hard for you to see the markings here on the bottom, but this is the Illinois and St. Olivar marking. There are quite a few scratches on the bottom of this, and the picture is taken in a lot of light when you see the picture, so you can't really see it quite as clearly as the same markings. This LR here is very common, and so is that in the Illinois system. But this one is an interesting piece. It's very similar to a silver cup that's by O'Neill, it's in the museum here. About the same size, too, actually. Okay, so what happened to Louis? Louis actually became a phantom for a while in our research. Tracked him really well, walked through St. Genevieve, and all of a sudden disappeared. So couldn't figure out where he went. So I got to do a little more detective work to see where the family moved to from St. Genevieve. It was clear he wasn't here anymore. So we started thinking, it's a pretty simple, no advanced science here. We started looking in circles around St. Genevieve. So changed a little bit, spelling on the name, but you could see some of the daughters, the same names of the daughters, and you could see a new name, a guy by the name of Monroe, which turned out really to be just a new name that the son was born to, where Francois, maybe he thought that was too French or something to work out in Mississippi, but anyway, we believe he changed his first name to Monroe, and actually the spelling of his first name was the same as his mother's, so I think maybe it was done for, who knows what reason, but he could have had a number of reasons, but dug enough to find that piece out. So they get to Natchez, the first daughter that gets married is Jean Genevieve, and she's his second daughter, the first, and then the first daughter, he's depending on his marriage next. We've got one artifact that maybe that the work was done in Mississippi. I'm not certain about that. It's a little bit speculative. But to look at it, the quality of the engraving on the label that it and the markings on it suggest it could be something that was either done prior, it could have been done in Detroit or possibly in Natchez because it doesn't bear a Illinois mark, which is something unusual. Kind of narrows it down a little bit to perhaps the area up around Detroit or maybe down in Natchez. I'm just not really sure. But this, the sons and the daughters all prospered quite well. They did well in Mississippi. They married well and got connected with families and the judges. And Monroe and Louis' son get together in business. Begin shipping goods up and down the Mississippi River, and they were making $25,000 a year for a couple of years. I mean, big money at the time, and that lasted for about four or five years. And if you were able to sell most of that away, you could probably retire and enjoy a nice life. We don't know what really happened to them in terms of what their day-to-day activity was. Let's go to the next chart. This piece of paper, which turned up almost at the very end of the research project that was here, which by the way took about 3 years to complete, just popped out of the woodwork down in Natchez. And it's a marriage contract. Those of you that have done any kind of genealogy work or historical research in the French period know that they exercise French law in North America. In Quebec province and in the south as well, along the Mississippi River. So what would happen? Kind of sounds a little reminiscent of what happens today in some cases where people make a marriage contract before they get married and try and say who's going to own what and who's bringing what to the table. And this at least getting separated a little bit easier or cleaner than you might. But this is exactly what you're looking at, just the tail end of the marriage contract. And the signatures here are amazing. This is where we found out about Louis Robitaille, the son, because it says Louis Robitaille, he's at the end, that's son. And we see the signatures of Francois Dallier, who's the man that his daughter, Junior Genevieve, now going by Junie, married. He was a baker and merchant in Manchester. See the signatures of Louise Robitaille. She says, born Monroe, so that's the mother. And here we see Louis, the silversmith's signature, very similar to what it's been in all the ones we've followed. A little shakier, maybe not quite as plain as it maybe was in some of the earlier documents, but he's a little bit older, and he's been working around toxic materials made in silver. Who knows what kind of shape. Philip Engel was a jeweler. He wasn't the Millers. These two Millers were actual silversmiths that moved from Savannah to Natchez. And one of them left shortly after this. The other stayed and took over the business and was brought in established. And there's another signature here that's
pretty important for that part of town, that part of the country. It's this guy, Ferdinand. Claymore was quite a character. He was, he raised his own regiment during the Civil War. He was a businessman, you know, sort of an extraordinary figure in life kind of person in the Natchez area. So, interesting collection of signatures on this one. It tied down a number of loose ends. From this point forward, I think I have the one picture to look at. This one is actually pretty clean design. Very, very nice, good quality engraving on the handle, and the structure of the thing is really nicely done. So you tend to think that maybe this came from a little bit later period of this thing's practice. So good at that. You don't see the Illinois marking, just three ORs on the road. This was courtesy of Maurice, a resident who helped me. He lives up in St. Louis and is really knowledgeable about silver. This is a word. So the other piece that we found finally, I corresponded and I called back and forth the agents with the folks at the cemetery at Natchez, the Natchez City Cemetery, which is a lovely place. It's really got a lot of history to it. Couldn't get any data. Finally, one of the guys who worked at the church in town went over and took some pictures of the graveyard. And then this stone is Louise's wife's grave. And there's a couple of others around there. The tall one is his son, Louis. His son, Monroe, when they changed his name, was buried in the Bronx. And there's a couple of other children residing in that plot. So we finally located the family. Find a resting place for where he's moving himself. And I'm a little speculative here, but Natchez had two cemeteries. In real early days, it was a Spanish Catholic church in Natchez. And there was a small cemetery associated with that that was active until the new city cemetery was developed. When the new city cemetery was developed, I was told that a lot of the graves were moved. It took forever, and it wasn't a real clean process. And some people got moved, some people didn't. And I've yet to find the records for the Spanish church. But I'm not giving up. I'm going to find them someday. We'll find out if we use perhaps very poor. The timing would have been right because there were only two other documents that we had there that would have placed his death probably somewhere between 1806, 1807. Not that far off the time that some of his contemporaries in the trade passed in maybe 5 or 10 years. So it's possible. Anyway, that's all I have for you this morning. I hope that gives you a brief introduction to Louis, the guy who was here before Antoine. Actually, the other guy was a Louis too, it was Louis Coito, so the two of them were sort of contemporaries. Any questions?
What is the total number of pieces that are known?
So there's probably about maybe 15 to 18 pieces. But I suspect there's probably more. I mean, the main functional type of stuff, mostly tableware. Store forks and spoons. You know, you go to an antique shop around here, just take a look, you know, see if there's an LR on the back. That's one of his things. You know what the hallmark looks like now. If you find one, let me know. I've given Bob my paper in its entirety. Contact information. So I'd love to hear about it. Or if you learn anything more about Louis, just by something you find from the town, I'd appreciate it. Thank you. I didn't go through all of the details because it's in the paper. He bought a place from. I was going to do this, but I decided that it'd just be too much here to cut through all these different things. He bought a house in town. He bought a house from Jean-Baptiste Placette for 80 piastres. And he kept it. And about a year later, he sold it to Maxwell. And Maxwell bought it for 80 piastres, so he lost 5 piastres on the deal. You know, but after that, it's very obvious that the guy still lived here because his name shows up in public records and a lot of the old early French records of the town for the next almost 10 years. So he had to live somewhere, and I've not been able to find anything out about that. And I've talked with Carl Edberg and asked if there were maps that might show the location of houses and stuff, but he couldn't help me. He said, no, it's just a simple house that he lived in. It had a lot, 110 feet long and 69 feet wide, and it was a three-room house, so that could have been any one of a number of places that were here then. So anyway, I have a limited number of copies of the paper. If you're really interested in getting a copy of it, Rob has my contact information. He
or
has
just
a soft copy of it.
Email the foundation.
Yeah. So be certainly glad to share that. Okay. Yes?
On those marks on there, were there any date marks?
No. It was not very common back in that period to date silver with a date mark on it. I mean, I've seen that on a few pieces, but the early silver was usually just a maker's mark and perhaps the pseudo mark, like I showed you with the line, you know, that would say Canada or even England. In fact, they used the same mark.
What type of pseudo mark you call it?
Pseudo mark, yeah. Because it's not a person's hallmark. It's like an extra mark that's there that doesn't attribute itself to any one individual.
But just the country of origin, or
city of origin. Yes.
Because in England they've got the supplant lion, mm-hmm. and there's kind of a mask for it that was made in London, mm-hmm. Birmingham,
right.
Had the anger. So
I'm not aware that they had any of that degree of finite information
once
on the stuff that was made
yeah.
in Quebec, at least for the period when he was there. All right, well, thank you very much.
Becky has roots in St. Genevieve that go back to the early French and some German, but the early French Digonia family, close, Digonia. Since 2006, Becky has become an enthusiastic researcher of history and genealogy. She's also an artist and a member of the art field here in St. Genevieve, and is an accomplished period clothing seamstress. Anyone who has seen her in her Civil War or colonial era costumes can attest to that. Recently, Becky has taken up the fundraising leadership role through the Presbyterian Church's efforts to rehabilitate the circa 1820 Antoine O'Neill House, which is on Main Street next door to the Presbyterian Church. Similar to Louis Robitaille, Antoine O'Neill was a St. Genevieve silversmith. The O'Neill Rehabilitation Project will be in concert with the mission of the Foundation for the Restoration of St. Genevieve. So we invited her here today to give you an update on the project. I give you Becky Millinger. Some of you have heard me speak before at the Foundation events about Antoine O'Neill's house, and I'm moving along a little bit with my research of him, but basically I'm going to give you an update. If you have not heard this before, I have brochures. I'll give them to Jill to start passing around if you're interested. It just goes into a little bit about the capital fund. The Presbyterian Church purchased the house in 2006, and I, being an outsider, have made the mistake of calling the house the O'Neill House, and people look at me funny and they say, oh, you mean the Thurman House. The man who owned the house before the church purchased it was Mel Thurman, which many of you know, and he has a very colorful history, but he was in the person who actually cut the top off of the building. It was a two-story Victorian kind of Queen Anne type style at the turn of the century. We don't know what the house looked like when Antoine bought it, but it was two-story. We've had a historic structures report that was done last year in June through November, and we were able to really go through and take that house, what's left of it apart, to see the different periods of wood and just the idea of how he'll live there and did he possibly do his silversmithing in the house. We don't think that he did because there is a original fireplace that's there. We know that the family lived in the house, so he most likely had to work outside. There was probably an outbuilding. But when the church took the house over in 2006, we purchased it for the express purpose of making something useful for our church. Meeting rooms, the upstairs will be a youth center. So it is kind of a story and a half the way it is right now. But unfortunately, in 1982, it was partially destroyed by fire. And then with the two floods that we've had here in the 90s, it has had a lot of Mississippi River damage. So the house has been described as being ravaged by every pestilence known to man. And so it's in kind of poor shape. But the historic structures report was really encouraging that we do have a lot there that we can save. We will do adaptive reuse of some of that building. There are some beaded beams in the front two rooms that we'll try to accentuate when we renovate. That, people ask me, when is that work going to start? It won't start until at least June of 2017 because right now we're involved in a capital campaign. We were very fortunate in 2011 was when I began working on this project, but we were actually contacted by the Tom Jeffers Foundation of Wisconsin. Historic Preservations will probably know that name when they hear it. Mr. Jeffers, his family foundation is for renovating and rehabilitating and saving old historic homes that are in towns that are smaller than 5,000 population. So we were exactly what they were looking for. They called us and said, can we help? They came down, looked at the building, offered us a grant. We received half of our structures report cost from them. And then when that was completed and sent to them, then they offered us another grant. And so we were very blessed to have that just fall in our lap. And so we began June 30th of this year a capital campaign fund. And that capital fund requires us to earn $200,000 toward their $100,000. And they've already given us that money, but for us to keep it, we have to raise money. So I'm the chairperson of that committee. This brochure was put together by people on my committee. Jill Kinnick is a person who has just become new to our community last year. She is a silversmith, and we're going to show you some of her work. She took the O'Neill Silver Trade Cross, which was probably one of his most
trade cross
well-known pieces that people recognize of his work. And she inspired and made that ornament. So we're selling these things. And Jill has created another little charm that has the O'Neill house on it. If you're interested in buying these, we're not really here to plug that, but we were told we could. The bracelets, which I have one on, they're $25. The ornaments are $20. Jill wants to incorporate every year the capital fund a new ornament to add to the collection so we can keep it active. I actually was given the suggestion by Jim Baker that when I first started talking to him about it, where is all the work of O'Neill? And he said, well, I don't even know. And so I have been on a quest. And I just published this book. It's one of a kind. There aren't any more. But I've been collecting images of O'Neill's work. And he really did have quite a bit of silver work around. There's some in Canada, a lot here. He was with John Aston, fur trader and merchant, who was up around the Detroit area and Vincennes area. And O'Neill was commissioned to do a 1,000-piece order of Indian trade work. Now, we're not sure if that cross, which is at the Windsor's Museum in Canada, this one, I don't know if you're all familiar with that, but that cross was found in a burial site in Amherstburg, Windsor, in Ontario in 1890, and the man who found it, who bought it, I don't remember if there was ever that much information, but George MacDonald
actually gave it to the Windsor's Museum, which is where it's on display right now. But Jill took that image and created her little inspired piece. So we've done an awful lot of research on O'Neill, and we'd like to present that. We have 3 years to earn our money, so we've been very active. Tonight, if you're not doing anything, we have Trivia Night at the American Legion Hall. We'd love to have you. You don't have to have a reservation for that. We're going to just have a good night of fun, and we're asking the community to get involved to help us raise this money. It should be a community effort because St. Genevieve is known for its historical preservation. And so as a community, I think we should take pride in the fact that we're going to be able to save this house. It will not be open to the public as a museum per se, but during historical events like Jour de Fête and the Heritage Day, Christmas Walk, you will have people there in historical attire, and we'll give a little brief information about the house and show people in the center part of the house there will be a display of O'Neill. There are some pieces of silver here that will possibly be donated to that display where people can actually see O'Neill's work and get a little feel for his genealogy. He's a very interesting man. Jill always says, put on his clothes every day and went to work. He didn't think of himself as an artist, but he was a very, very good craftsman. His work is pretty refined for the period and for how he did it in a forge and with a hammer, you know. So if you look at some, if you want to look at this book, please see me afterward. But basically, he just did his job. And it's unfortunate that a couple of pieces of his work actually have, they carry the name of the rich merchant who ordered them. So the Francis Vigo pieces are O'Neill's work, but they carry his name. So I think most artisans, when we do our work, we know we do it for someone to pay for, and then they often get the credit for it. But I'm really excited to be a part of this project, and I think that we're going to do well. We just got started. We've been up about 3 months. We know we have to raise a certain amount of money per month, and we've done that. But I'm just excited that the town's supporting us, especially that the foundation is supporting us. And if you have any questions about anything about the house, I don't want to take up too much time because we're getting ready to start again. But I'll be happy to talk to you about it. And if I know it, I'll tell you. I'm sorry? No, there's only one. But eventually, Jill and I were just talking. We are planning some pretty major events, but maybe in 2016, which we think could be the year that O'Neill actually came to St. Genevieve. All of that is really nebulous because there aren't a lot of documents, but we're thinking about having a silver symposium where we would invite people. Morris Muslin has been a real good friend to me in the last 6 months and giving me information, and I know we've had some offers today of people that might be able to help us. We'd like to get people to come down and talk about Louis Rotai and Couteau and some of those people who were here because, you know, we think about artisans today and what they do, but back then those guys traveled around, they were selling, you know, they were traveling salesmen, kind of, and then they did their work in ways that, you know, I don't know if I would want to bang out this piece with a hammer and you know, melting coins to make his work. So there's a real story behind all of it, and you know, everybody who talked today triggered me to think about, well, I need to go research that, and Judy's, I need to go research, you know, because I think that all of these things are intertwined in our history, and so it's really important for us to look into those. And so we are planning that Silver Symposium in 2016, and I hope that we will be able to offer these at that time. Because to my knowledge, there is not a collection of his compiled work. You can find bits and pieces of it. So I'm hoping that we'll be able to offer this at some time. And if we do that, it would be going to the capital fund. It would not go to anybody's private money. So are there any other questions?
Do you have a street address?
Well, it's 150 South Main. It's down on the south end of Main. It's right at the trestle at Gallery and Main Street. In fact, Steve had the house picture of the Hoffman House. Our church is just really close to the Hoffman House, so it's right on Main.
Next to the church.
It's right next to the church. We do. We have, Jill has the examples if you want to come up and see him. She has a swipe card if you want to pay a credit card, or take a check or cash. And then I have a poster that has the prices, but yes, I have some with me, so please. Yes. That's what I'm by all of them. Does anybody else have a question?
How do you make a check?
Make a check out to the First Presbyterian Church, and then on the memo line, if you put jewelry, we're trying to keep it, and we have to keep it separate from the Jeffers Foundation. Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot one of the most important things. We are very active this year in the community and historical events. And October 25th is the historic Rural Heritage Day. Jill's going to be dressed in the attire that the period when O'Neill was here. She's going to have a silversmithing demonstration on the porch of the O'Neill house. And she's going to actually give you a chance to pick up the hammer and get a feel for what it was like to hit on metal. And we're going to actually start that at the Art Walk, which is the night before on the 24th. And we'll be selling the jewelry at that time. And we'll have people there that can give a little information. We won't be able to let you go into the house, unfortunately. It isn't safe enough for everybody to walk in. But you look at the windows, and I'll be there. And if you have any questions about any part of the house, we'll be happy to answer. Who was it that was asking about the metal? We have some detectionists who are coming in the fall with metal detectors, and they're going to go on that property, and they're going to see. We know that that back porch was enclosed later, and we wonder maybe if there could be some silver coins that fell through the cracks. And the back part of that house had a lot of termite damage, so we'll be able to go through dirt and sift through that. We're hoping we'll get something.
They're really fun.
If we don't, it'll be fun. Yeah. If we don't find anything, but maybe we'll find a silver coin from Spanish or French, who knows? So, anybody else? Thank you very much, we appreciate it.
I'd like to make this presentation to Becky in memory of Ann. We have put a little money to it and rounded it up to $500.
Thank you, I really appreciate it. Ann Cassidy was one of the first people I met, and she was so sweet. She loved my tiger chair. I don't remember when I won all of the chair painting contest. She was a very, very sweet person. So thank you so much. Our church will be very appreciative. I'll be reporting tomorrow in the morning of all the things we learned this weekend. So thank you. I appreciate that.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you. So the fundraising jewelry for the O'Neill House is here, and you can look at it, and we'll also have it available for sale again at our afternoon break at about 2:45. But from now until about 10 after 1 when we reconvene over here, it's first come, first serve.
7 and 98 TV and web broadcasting are made possible through contributions and donations from viewers like you. Thank you for your support.